and welcome to Gazette discussion for 1st July 2021. My name is Harsh Singh, and in today's discussion, we will talk about many interesting articles through this Gazette. Now, our discussion will be divided in two videos. The first video will contain the featured news, that is on private sector in clean energy, and the second video will be about all the other important articles of the day. Right? Now, the first news is on private sector in clean energy. Now, in this article, we will understand what is clean energy, what is the difference between renewable energy and clean energy, and then what is the need of private sector investment, what are the opportunities and challenges associated. Right? This is a wholesome article in itself in one particular video. The second video will contain a number of articles, short articles. The first article will be about this day in history we dedicate to National Doctors Day and to a particular person. We will know who in this short update. The new snapshots, we've got three of them for you today. The first one is on India trying to become Atmanirbhar, self-reliant in the production of phosphatic fertilizers. We have been importing a huge quantity of phosphatic fertilizers and now we want to produce them in India. This is what the article is about. The second one is on Niti Aayog's, our think tank, national think tank's research on the not-for-profit hospitals in India. Right? There are two kinds of hospitals, the one which want to make profit out of the consumer's expenditure and the one which don't want to. So the ones which don't want to, we will have a short understanding of them through Niti Aayog's report. And the third article is about advanced deep technology-based research promotion in India by the government. Right? Image of the day. We have got an interesting image of the day which talks about the NASA's research. Right? And here we understand how the upper atmosphere is cooling, not heating, but cooling because of the impact of the global warming. Right? Interesting. Now, four terms we have. One is Natrax. We don't know, but we will come to know what it is. Energy compact related to sustainable development goal number 7. And then we have Bhari Tala Susas Tapani, an organism. Right? We'll come to know more. And then heat dome, important term. Right? So these are the four terms we discussed today. Editorial of the day, we've got one important editorial on police reforms. And then a case study where we take you to Mozambique, this particular municipality, Quilimane municipality, and we'll discuss what wonders they are creating here. Right? Okay. So let us begin the discussion. This day in history is dedicated to Dr. Bidhan Chandra Roy. He was born on this day, and this day is dedicated to all the doctors in India. This National Doctors Day is celebrated around the world on different dates, but this specific date has been chosen because we also want to felicitate Dr. Bidhan Chandra Roy, and he was an important person who participated in the creation of Indian Medical Association and the Medical Council of India, MCI and IMA. Right? Now, he was also the Chief Minister of Bengal at an important time, and he also received the prestigious award called as Bharat Ratna, right? The highest civilian honor in the country. Right? So please remember the name Dr. Bidhan Chandra Roy. Proceeding to the news updates, important updates. The first snapshot for today is about India trying to become Atmanirbhar, that means self-reliant on phosphatic fertilizers. Now, three important fertilizer components that we use are nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium, right? Potassium stands for K, NPK, right? And the proportion of all these three components have to be used to create a particular fertilizer, right? Ideally, this proportion has to be 4:2:1. However, this proportion is distorted. Why? Because see, nitrogen is also found in India, but phosphorus and potash, these both are largely imported, right? And therefore, there's a tendency for farmers to use this nitrogen. Why? Because, see, majorly, they are not only imported, they're also dependent on the international market price, right? And during the times of COVID, the prices of all these components, potash and phosphorus, they have shot up. And that is the reason that it is very tough for us to import. The government has to increase the subsidy also. And we have covered this in our news, in our Gazette news as well, how we are trying to give more subsidy for potash, right? Now, here in this article, we talk that India has got a huge amount of resources of rock phosphate. And therefore, instead of importing it, why not utilize our own rock phosphate and create phosphate out of it, right? This will help in supplementing the need of the fertilizer industry. This will help reducing the amount of the imports that we have in this sector. And that is how this article will also proceed, right? Now, India is right now dependent as much as 90%, right? A key raw phosphate used in DAP. DAP is one of the important fertilizers after urea. Urea has a good concentration of nitrogen, right? DAP has a good mix of phosphate as well and rock phosphate, right? And India is dependent 90% on the imports of it, right? Now, there is volatility in the international market. We have seen that, right? Because of international supply and demand, and also because of COVID, and therefore we want to domesticate all of it, right? And interestingly, we have got the reserves. So let us see the reserves, right? India has got huge amount of reserves in Jharkhand, in Rajasthan, in Madhya Pradesh, and then in states like Uttar Pradesh and Uttarakhand as well. You will be shocked to know that Jharkhand reserves are not being utilized right now. Rajasthan is the highest producer of phosphate, right? So you will right now see that Rajasthan is producing as much as 92% of the phosphates in India. That means only one state, around 30% of it, is contributing 92%. That means there are unused phosphates, right? So this is where we need to start using the phosphate resources in the country, right? Make India self-reliant, right? And why is phosphate important? Now, here is the answer. Phosphate is important because it helps in the development of that particular plant, right? Not in the soil, not other things, but plant. The growth of the plant is assisted by phosphate. It helps in the development of roots, right? Seed development and plant maturation, right? So this is how phosphate is very important for any plant. Moving ahead, what are the steps that government has taken to ensure the fertilizers are available at subsidized price? Because they are imported, the price is not nominal, and therefore government tries to subsidize this, right? So government has introduced two schemes. One is subsidy for urea, and the other one is nutrient based subsidy, right? So these are two important different schemes, one only for urea and the other is dependent on the nutrient. Now, in urea, the government fixes the price of urea in the market and then gives the subsidy, the whole subsidy amount, to the company producing it, right? So the price of market is fixed of urea, and the whole leftover subsidy, right, that is given to the organization. So this is urea-based subsidy. Nutrient-based subsidy is dependent on the nutrient used in the particular component. So what are the kind of various fertilizers? So for example, we have DAP, MOP, SSP. These are the various kind of fertilizers based on the proportion of the ammonium, phosphate, then potash used here, the subsidy is decided. Also, the subsidy is given to the particular organization at a particular level. However, if the organization is innovating better products, it will sell this particular product at a cheaper rate in the market, and hence it will be more competitive. And this is how government is trying to promote competition in this nutrient sector, in this fertilizer nutrient sector, right? Okay, so this is what is NBS. Now, we are trying to make the whole production indigenous. So this is very important and to be noted, especially for phosphates, right? And we are trying to substitute all of this. So in this article, all you got to note is NBS, nutrient based subsidy, the amount of production happening in India right now with phosphates, and what is required, what we want with the amount of reserves that we have. So examples of Jharkhand and Rajasthan could be given, right? And you can also talk of the reason, why do we need this? This is the most important component of the answer. The volatility in price and the COVID situation, also the kind of subsidy we have to give while we import, right? If we are producing it at India itself, the prices automatically will be less, and therefore subsidy from the government will be less, right? So this is an important article from agricultural sector particular point of view, and also from the point of view of government deficit, right? The deficit, the subsidy will get reduced if we use these kind of important Atmanirbhar schemes, right? The second article is on not-for-profit hospital model. So there are two models for hospitals, for any organization. One is to run on profit and the other one is not to run on profit, right? So in the one in which one doesn't run on profit, all is done is that if there is incoming revenue, the revenue will not be utilized to create profit for the owner, right? It could be reinvested in the organization for its growth. The rates will be reduced so that profit is not the main motive, right? So this is how the Niti Aayog has done research on these kind of hospital model, right? So it says that non-profit organizations, right? It has given the difference here for for-profit organized hospitals and not-for-profit organizations. So not-for-profit accounts for only 1% of the treatment of ailments, and 23.3% is for for-profit hospitals. Also, the inpatient, that means patient who live there for more than one day inside the hospital, right? So 55% of them are treated in for-profit hospitals and only 2.5% in inpatient department in the not-profit hospitals. So after giving these statistics, the government, the article talks about what is the benefit of using non-for-profit hospitals. So first benefit is that it has lower charge, right? They will charge low because they don't want more profits. They will always charge low, right? The second one is that they're usually empaneled with government for some of the other schemes. What is empanelment? It means that if anybody is insured, if a government employee is insured, if an individual is insured, so government will ask them to go to these hospitals, right? Because it is cheaper on the pocket for the government as well, okay? So these are empaneled hospitals. Then they try to cut down on the cost. How? For example, the salaries given there will be less. This is important feature, right? Their procurement will be done at mass level. They will be procuring products at mass scale. That means they will be reducing the cost of procurement, right? Then the workforce use will be multitasking, right? So they can handle multiple things at the same time. So they have to pay less for getting all the tasks done, right? They have low operating costs. They will not be very expensive in operations, right? And they will focus on quality. So these are some of the important features of not-for-profit hospitals. And this is what Niti Aayog has also found out, right? This is the idea to start using not-for-profit hospitals for development of the medical sector in the nation. This will help in social development as well, okay? But there are some challenges that they face. First of all, you know, the first challenge is retention of such doctors and recruitment as well. Why? Because doctors, if given less salary, would not prefer a hospital like this. So this is the challenge number one. Reimbursement for treatment, right? When these empaneled hospitals ask the government that, yes, we have done the payment, we have done the treatment, please pay us. So there is a delay in the payment procedure. How will they run? It becomes very tough for them to run, right? Then infrastructure and equipment expansion. Now, if they have less money, less finances with them, how will they be able to expand themselves? This is another issue, right? And then they have high compliance burden, right? They have a lot of regulatory laws, norms fixed. And because of this, it is tough for them to operate, right? So these are the challenges. Okay. The third article is about the deep technology-based research in India. The government is trying to promote some kind of transformative technology, a disruptive technology which transforms the whole Indian scenario in the coming few years itself. So for example, if we have something like the cryptocurrency for the government, right? So this is one. If we have a transformative artificial intelligence, cloud-based artificial intelligence for the nation, right? So these are some very transformative technologies which can just completely change the face of the development of the country. And this is where the Science Engineering Research Board, SERB, they have had a pact with Intel India, right, to create such kind of scope for India, deep technology-based research. So what will they research in? They will research in important sectors like artificial intelligence, machine learning, security, cloud technology, etc. So the main idea is to develop these technologies at indigenous level, not to import them, not to have them from other countries, but to have them at our own country. And this is where this initiative of the government has come into role, right? So idea is to develop futuristic science and technology methods, right? Now, some background of this about India's development. Now, India is a country which has been increasing its spending in technology research. However, if you look at the percentage of spending, it is very minimal, right? India is spending less than 1% of GDP in research and development, right? Compared to a country like Israel, right, spending almost 5% of GDP in research and innovation, right? Now, this is very less and pity for India, big country like India, to spend so less on research and innovation. And this is why we win less of these important awards, the global awards. We receive less of important awards globally in terms of innovation, just because we spend less, right? There is less credit for innovation in the country. our people, our own people study abroad and they innovate abroad, but India itself is not able to do it because we don't invest as much, right? So when we see this, the investment in India has been only falling with time. See, now it is 0.7% of GDP. We also had 0.84 a few years back, a decade back. And if you look at the BRIC nations, right, if you look at these countries here, India's spending is very less in the as a percentage of GDP. So India stands at 0.69 and we have South Korea 4.3, Israel, and then Japan almost 3.5, USA 2.73%, China 2%, and India is 0.7. So India is the least in BRICS nations, right? We cannot compare ourselves with Pakistan, which has 0.29, almost half of India, right? However, we have to increase our percentage of spending, not just the total spending. So this is what is the most important part of the article about. Image of the day. Now, this image is produced from NASA's website. NASA has researched on the atmosphere of the Earth, and it says that the outer atmosphere of the Earth, right? They talk about the upper atmosphere of Earth, and this atmosphere is cooling. It is not only cooling, it is contracting. So if you look at NASA's website, what they're showing is a dynamic image of the contraction in the upper atmosphere of the Earth, right? And it is contracting and cooling specifically because the lower part of the Earth is heating up. The lower part of the Earth atmosphere is heating up and this part is contracting. And NASA contributes this to the rise in global temperatures. So this is a very interesting image, right? This could be a question, right? They can ask, what is the atmosphere, upper atmosphere of Earth? Is it contracting or is it expanding as a result of the global warming, right? And this is where we come to understand the layers of the Earth atmosphere quickly. So now, right now, we were talking of mesosphere. We were talking of mesosphere. This is contracting and this is also cooling, not heating, cooling. So troposphere is the first layer. Then we have stratosphere. The third is mesosphere. And then we have thermosphere and exosphere, right? The most interesting part is that the temperature here, the first part in the troposphere, the temperature here decreases with height. You know why? It decreases because the lowermost part has got more particulate matter and therefore it heats up first. And right, and their rarefied atmosphere will get less heated up. Also, the insulation strikes the ground first. So this part is most heated and then less heat as we go up. So as we approach the edge of troposphere, then heating is reduced. It goes as much as minus 50 degrees Celsius, right? But what happens in stratosphere? Now, this is the second level of atmosphere where the temperature starts to increase. Why does it start to increase? Because this is the place where ozone is trapped. And ozone is not only trapped, but it also takes in energy, solar radiations in itself. So because of this, this part gets heated up, right? This is the part where ozone is also trapped, the harmful ozone gases, the harmful ozone, right? After that, we have the third layer, mesosphere. Now again, because it is getting distant from the Earth, the temperature again decreases, right? So we see another decrease in temperature. But after that, we have thermosphere and exosphere. If we approach sun, the temperature will increase. If we go away from sun, the temperature will decrease, right? So this is the pattern in which the temperature changes happen and NASA's image. Now, terms and concept. The first term and concept is NATRAX. What is NATRAX? NATRAX is National Automotive Test Tracks. Now, there is something called as OEM. What is OEM? Original Equipment Manufacturer. Right? These are those companies which participate in the manufacturing of small equipments for the vehicles. This is an example. Now, Toyota, Tata, Maruti, Suzuki, Hyundai, Honda. These are the companies that we look at when we purchase the vehicles. But have you heard of Minda Industries? Have you heard of Mother and Sumi? Now, these are the market leaders which manufacture the small gadgets required in the car. For example, the windshield, the brakes, the tires, right, the wheel drum. All these things are manufactured by these companies. So these are OEMs. Now, these companies, they take their vehicles abroad. OEMs take their vehicle abroad for testing. We don't have such facilities to test these vehicles in India. And therefore, India has developed this facility in Indore, right? This facility called as high-speed track, NATRAX, in India, in Indore. And the idea here is to be able to test the vehicles, test their faster speed, test how much they turn during curves, test what is their mileage, test what is their constant speed, right? So this track has been developed at Indore, and this is one of the longest tracks in the Asia, the fifth longest in the world and the longest track in Asia. This is around 12 kilometers in length. 12 kilometers in length. This is a testing track, and the cars can run here at as much as 375 kilometer per hour speed. So this is what India has developed. People won't have, OEMs won't have to go abroad to test their vehicles. So please remember, Natrax, is it space technology, science technology, vehicle technology? So you understand it very well now. Energy Compact. What is Energy Compact? Now these are the voluntary commitments. The voluntary commitments the organizations are giving. Anybody, even you can give, I can give, or organizations can give, right? They gain credibility by giving voluntary contributions that, okay, I will decrease this much amount of energy consumption, the fossil energy consumption or the dirty energy consumption. Now NTPC has become the first energy company in this domain in India to declare their compact goals, right? So this is a voluntary declaration, and this is the difference between nationally determined contributions, intended nationally determined contributions, and the energy compact. This is voluntary declaration, but this is a declaration by the whole country, right? This is declared by the government, but this is declared by a company, individual, and voluntary organizations, right? So all of them participate in their own way. News is because NTPC also participated in it, and therefore we must know what is Energy Compact about, right? What is this about? Now, Sustainable Development Goal 7 talks about energy transition, right? So first part is energy access. The second one is transition, and the third one is inclusion, right? So first is to have access to this kind of clean, affordable, reliable energy. Clean, affordable, reliable energy, right? And then we have to transit to using the cleaner energy more. And after that, we have to have a better rate of energy efficiency in this kind of transition, right? So first of all, we have to have access, and then we have to transit into the newer kind mix of energy, right? Clean energy, and then later we have to make it more energy efficient. So this is how it will transit in Sustainable Development Goal number 7, right? So this is what the article also mentions. The third snapshot is about Bhari Tala Suchus Tapani, right? So this name has a meaning. We will come to know that all the technical names do have some meanings at times. So this is a carnivore, right? It is found, it has been built again. The structure has been built again after researching. Bhari means huge, right? In the local language, Telugu language, where it has been found. And Tala means head, and Suchus means the Egyptian crocodile-headed deity, god, right? So crocodile-headed god, which is huge, which has got a huge head. This is what it means. And the structure of the organization drawn is something like this, right? This is almost the size of a lion. It is a reptile, and it used to exist in India around 240 million years back. It also existed in some other form in other continents, but this is the youngest one which has been found in the Indian subcontinent, right? Now, the interesting thing to note about this is that this organism was the predator of its own kind, and probably the largest predator in its own ecosystem, right? So the head also has been found, the whole body has been recreated, right? Remember the name and why this organism has been in news. Fourth, heat dome in North America. Now what is a heat dome? Heat dome, very simple, it's a dome and it's heat. So if a region gets heated and this dome also appears, somehow it appears, this is a heat dome, that's it. Now, what is the technicality? We will just get into it. Now, there are places which get heated because of some several reasons, right? So if they get heated, and if there is a high pressure area forming just above that place, that means air is subsiding. If there is high pressure, then air will subside, air will come down. If there is a low pressure area, then air will tend to rise. So at a place where there is already heat, right, it will try to go up, I do agree. But if there is incoming subsidence of air, then this air will not be able to escape in the atmosphere. In fact, a dome will form, a virtual dome will form, and it will prevent the air to go up. This is what is happening in northwest side of America. At Portland, at Seattle, the temperatures have gone above 37 degrees Celsius this summer. Now, these places where people do not use fans at all. There is no air conditioner. These places are very cold. 6 to 7 months, it is very cold. It is sub-zero here at these places, but they have gone as much as 37 degrees Celsius in temperature this summer because of the formation of heat dome. How does it form? Now, it forms specifically in La Nina years. This is the time when the normal conditions are exaggerated. Now, normal conditions are the one where the Western Pacific and has the warmer temperature and the Eastern Pacific has lesser temperature, right? So there is subsidence of air at the Western Pacific coast, and there is more subsidence of air in the La Nina years. And in the times when there is more heat at the Earth's surface in this nearby area, there is heat and there is extra subsidence of air. This is why this dome is formed. So a unique feature which forms only specifically and especially during La Nina years. This is what has formed in the west coast of American continent, right? Editorial of the day. This is an important editorial related to police reforms. The editorial says that an important police reform was presented in the form of Prakash Singh versus Union of India case judgment by the Supreme Court in 2006. It spoke about a lot of things. For example, having a permanent 2-year tenure for the DGP. It also spoke of various things like police complaint committee. It spoke about the transfer and statutory powers to be placed among the police officers. For example, transfer postings have to be decided by a particular committee. So these were the various provisions, but they have not been implemented by the governments of various states. However, police is still entitled with a lot of functions. Important functions of it are NOC, non-objection certificate. Now, one important function of the police with relation to non-objection certificate is, for example, if one is shifting to an important place, a tenant, they have to be verified. If a housemaid is going to work, they have to be verified. If a restaurant has to be opened, it has to be verified. So not only business, but individuals are also impacted by this NOC. And there was a finding which said that 45 such services are required to be given by the police, the local police, right? But most of the states, they fail to give these services to the required people. And this is where reforms are required. The article says that reforms can be done at two levels. First level is by the organization, the people themselves asking for the change. And the second level is through use of electronic means, through e-governance, right? So this is what the article mentions. The case study of the day. In case study, we take you to Mozambique. Now, this is a country which is in south of the Africa continent, and the particular municipality here, Quelimane municipality, has presented a very good role model for development of this municipality. Now, what have they done is they have managed the waste resources, the local food, in a way that soil is upgraded and nutrition is also provided to the soil. The waste is not wasted, it is utilized, right? So what have they done? They collect the waste, they ensure that the waste goes for use of energy creation, and then whatever is left out is also used as nutrient, right? So this is going to collect the waste and utilize it again for various activities, right? So for example, now allied activities like rainwater harvesting, watershed development, all of them come together along with this, right? So they have started a lot of projects along with a few projects, right? So one project gives stimulus to the other project and then to the next project. And this is how the chain reaction will complete the whole recycling process. And that's where they have been awarded very well, right? So how does it help? It helps in making the land resource better. It makes the waste management better, right? Organic agriculture is also practiced and we have better harvest. So many benefits just through starting of the cycle, just collection of this agricultural waste, the food waste, can help in so many ways, right? The whole cycle gets repeated. So as an administrator, you can imagine where you want to start reforming the system, and the whole cycle will complete. It will start with you and it will finish with the new product completely, right? So this is the case study of the day. Do remember and note down the place, right? The place in Mozambique, the place is called as Quelimane Municipality, right? Thank you for watching.